Welcome back, everybody, to the Gigabyte Challenge number 4, second semifinals of the day, and it's going to be one hell of an exciting match to them. The match that I'm most excited about because I get to see my American brethren face off once again in what's going to be a fun little rematch best of one of the TI4 American Qualifier Finals. It's Team Liquid versus North American Rejects, and let's hop right into it, guys, so we can cover the draft as well as welcome in my co-caster, who's going to be none other than Evil Genius's PPD.
Yep, Antidota Specialist. I'm ready.
I hope you are, man. This is it's fun. We already had a little bit of smack talk going in during the lobby time, so I really like the finals are obviously going to be great. Power Rangers did a great job in the first semifinals, so I'm sure they're going to be a tough opponent for whoever moves on here. But really, I mean, just since I come from America, I've watched so much American Dota, this for me is going to be really the highlight of the night.
I mean, I think the finals will be equally as exciting, but yeah, this is definitely a great match, and hopefully it's a good game.
So, already we got standard bans coming out of the Wiz, Murata, Darkseer, and Tree and Protector all being banned away, and to nobody's surprise whatsoever, Team Liquid first pick the Batrider, which they've been grabbing over and over again. Lycan and Shatter Demon is going to be the counter of North American Rejects, and now the Enchantress going the way of Team Liquid.
Yep, they picked the Enchantress, so that denies Lycan's ability to go Necrobook, usually. Usually you don't go Necrobook on Lycan against Enchantress unless you're getting multiple Necrobooks, so maybe if they pick up another hero, they might go for a Necro strat, but most likely he'll probably just go for a BKB instead of Necros and just try to be like a battle Lycan.
Now, do you feel that this new build that we have been seeing, since we're seeing Necrobooks being countered out oftentimes, as well as the nerf to Shapeshift as well, do you still value Lycan as much even when he does go for that battle build?
I think Lycan's still very, very strong, more so on Dire than Radiant, of course. Mm-hmm. They picked it first too, which I think is okay. I think that's fine, as long as they just play well around it and get enough of disables for Lycan to connect with his damage.
Well, we're going to see the Puck as well as the Dazzle being banned away by Team Liquid. Puck being one of the stronger setup, really good initiation for Lycan to be able to go in. Of course, Dream Call is one of the better disables to hold in some enemy heroes for Lycan to beat them down. Of course, the Dazzle as well just being a standard high-tier support right now, but works really well with the Shadow Demon. If any of you guys have seen that combo, the Disruption into the Shadow Wave actually gets yourself a pretty good burst amount of damage and also is a pretty insane defense combo going into some of those team fights, whether it's the Shallow Grave or the Disruption. You got a savior somewhere. Bane is going to be banned out by North American Rejects as well as Team Liquid's Ursa that they've been running quite a bit. Now, I'm sure, PPD, you watched the finals. We saw Ursa being picked up two different times in the finals, both by Team Liquid. Your thoughts on the hero, Team Liquid, and their specialty kind of being the only team running it so consistently?
Yeah, I think TC plays as one of, that's one of his best heroes for sure, and it's actually very good against Lycan, and they're also on Dire, so it would have been a pretty good pick if they could have got it. You're talking about Dazzle's like a high tier support. I don't really agree with you that much there. I think Dazzle got nerfed big time.
Okay.
Now that the Poison Touch doesn't stun levels 1 to 3, and then at level 4 it only stuns at the end. So it's like, it's actually like the hero's like actually really bad. But it's with the Shadow Demon, you were talking about the heal combo. That's actually pretty good. So that's probably the main reason why they banned it.
Okay, well, now we're just waiting on North American Rejects and their third pickup, Panda. You think so?
I don't know. Maybe they play it.
Well, they do play it. Snaking has picked it up before. In fact, that was in Game 4.
I haven't seen NAR play since the TI qualifiers. I mean, I'm sure they've been practicing, so let's see if they got anything new.
Well, picking up the Doom here, nothing too specific about a Doom going up against Enchantress or Batrider. I feel there's nothing too specific for a Doom, just... I mean, he is pretty versatile when he picked up this early in the lineup.
Yeah, they might. I don't know if Korok plays these heroes. I feel like we're still missing a Korok hero. But I could be wrong.
Yeah, that's true. Normally, Snake King is
It's gonna be Dragonite, I think.
Oh, so just going the mass tank sort of build.
Yeah, it's pretty good versus Bat. Mm-hmm.
So that
really
would leave
tanky
us.
Heroes.
Reserved that would leave us with the Doom in the offlane. So we've seen Doom in basically every single role ever. We've got, besides 5, we've seen him in the mid, we've seen him as a carry. He's also more popular being run as sort of an offlane or occasionally a really, really greedy support. For you, PPD, do you still, like, is a Doom 4 position all that viable? Do you like that, or do you just prefer to see him, like, offlane and occasionally run in jungle?
I don't like it as a 4, but if you can get away with it, I'm sure it's okay. Yeah. But I don't think you can get away with it against a good team. So, but it's most commonly done as either the offlaner or it's actually not too bad in the safe lane. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, because Liquid picked the Enchantress, they can get pretty greedy with their picks, I think. And they could even do a Lycan tri-lane offlane, or they could pick another hero and have Lycan, or have a tri-lane aggressive and then have Lycan mid and Doom safe lane. Or Lycan can kind of do okay against Bat if you play it perfect, one-on-one. Mm-hmm. But it's it can be a rough matchup sometimes if Lycan messes up.
Well, now the lone druid being grabbed, a hero that hasn't seen a whole lot of play lately. And also, I haven't seen Team Liquid running it too much. Now, I'm still presuming this is going to be a mid Bat Rider. So maybe we're seeing an offlane Lone Druid. This also could be a one position Lone Druid. So Team Liquid still have a little bit of wiggle room in their draft as well.
Yeah, I think it's one position. But I think that what they're going to try and do is get really aggressive with the Enchantress early, make enough space for this Lone Druid. And hopefully force NAR's offlaner off the lane, and then Lone Druid can take the tower by himself. Mm-hmm. And then just create enough space for Lone Druid to get either like a Radiance or a Maelstrom or something. I don't know. We'll see what kind of build he goes for.
Yeah, once they do force the Doom, if he is going to be an offlane, if they force him away, they also have they pick up another aggressive support here. They have a really good roaming combo early on. Just Enchantress being one of the better gankers for that mid position. Keeper of the Light, though, being grabbed by North American Rejects. We have seen a small rise of the Caudle. Not quite so sure if it's really viable. In fact, I think I've seen him in more losses than wins lately. Nahaz will have to be backing me up on that one, whether or not the stats actually concur. But I'm not really still sure about the Keeper of the Light. I kind of feel like the Aghanim's buff and the small things that have been changed still don't really find a place for him in the meta.
Yeah, I've never been too hot on the hero, but they had good success with him, so you may as well just keep playing it. It's pretty good against Lone Druid because you don't really get the BKB on the bear that much, so Blinding Light could be pretty effective.
That's true.
But I definitely think NAR is going to do dual lane offline with Caudle here. So maybe their last pick is going to be like a Clockwork, or maybe they'll just go up there with Doom. But they need something to punish the Bat Rider, I believe, because they're going to need Shadow Demon plus one in the safe lane. And I'm not sure if that hero is Lycan or if it's something else. Reserve time.
Well, even if they don't do that, they do have a small synergy between their two supports as well. The Disruption into the Keeper of the Light Blast. It's not the greatest damage, of course, but...
I don't think they're going to be laning together.
Yeah, so. You don't think so. Right. So just sticking with dual lane. Shadow Shaman being grabbed by Team Liquid, so they do have themselves a little bit more pushing power, so more reason for the Keeper of the Light, I suppose. The Brewmaster is going to be banned away by Team Liquid. Want to take away one of the more dangerous teamfight-oriented heroes, while the Pugna... banned out by North American Rejects, obviously wanting to limit Team Liquid's push as much as possible right now.
That was interesting. I didn't like if the Pugna Lone Druid is like a really like China prominent strategy. Like I think VG Gaming does those two cores a lot. So I mean, maybe Liquid's played it in scrims. I personally haven't seen them play Pugna. And yeah, there's their offlane. It's gonna be Centaur, and I think Carl's gonna join them up top.
Think Caudle and not the Shadow Demon, because in China that was a classic dual lane with the Shadow Demon Disruption, Soul Catcher into the extra damage for both Stomp and Double Edge.
I see your point. I still think it's going to be Caudle, just because Caudle can push the lanes, and Alchemist last pick. That's kind of cool. I like Alchemist.
So another big tanky hero to run up in front. That's going to be Bulba playing it. That means Demon's going to be on the...
Bat Rider,
since that is kind of one of his specialty heroes.
So maybe I think TC's playing support right now too.
Really? So that means are we going back to Way 2
Quickfoot Bear?
Okay, Quickfoot. Oh, that's
no,
right.
No, Way 2 and TC are playing support, I believe.
Yeah. There was a small period of time, I believe, where Way 2, they made that switch. I think when Demon first started playing them, like Way 2 was playing a little bit of carry there for just a small...
Yeah, it was like one day.
Yeah.
But now they have Bulba as like the captain and drafter, I believe. And then they have Demon on offlane slash mid, Bulba like swapping around with him, and then Quickfo playing carry. I think that's how it's working. 5 seconds remaining.
Well, we're going to see 1437 once again reprising his Keeper of the Light role. We got Brax is going to be playing that Centaur. I really like watching Brax play. I think he's a very versatile player. When it comes to offlanes, he just always has, it seems like every single game they play, they always pick up something different for him. Snake King's going to be playing the Lycan, not a big surprise there. And that leaves Korok on the Doom, while we have Fog going to be playing that Shatter Demon.
Is there any problems with my mic or anything?
There was a little bit of background noise earlier. I think I heard someone talking, but it's not as bad as it was the other day. So.
Okay, well, if it gets bad, let me know. I can try a couple things.
Okay. So lane matchup should be, a defensive tri-lane? Well, dual lane with jungling Enchantress. They have the Alchemist in the mid going up against... that should be a pretty favorable matchup, right? Like the Lycan versus the Alchemist. You got that constant acid spray going out. The possibility on stable concoction with the Enchantress smoke gank. That is as well is very, very strong.
Yeah, that's true. It's pretty much a free kill, I think, on Lycan. But if Shadow Demon has an early teleport scroll, they could probably save him with that disrupt. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
We do have all of them just kind of hiding out while Quaifa is going to be trying to scout out what exactly lanes are going to be. You see the Spirit Baron. They may actually be running an aggro try here with Shadow Demon. Disruption into the Stomp, into the Blast. That is a huge amount of nuking damage if they can catch anybody out. The problem is they're dealing with a lone druid in the one position who is one of the more defensive carries. Then as long as the supports don't get real close, all Quaifa really has to do is treat this like an offlane.
Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with this tri-lane decision by NAR. I feel like with a roaming Enchantress and Shadow Shaman, they can be really exploited, and lone druid can kind of just hold his own up there and not die, and then worst case scenario he can just jungle himself. And with no camps blocked, it should be okay. Oh, they're actually swapping lone druid to the offlane. Which that actually works pretty well.
So that means we're now gonna have Demon playing the Batrider in the safe lane, but he's dealing with an aggro try, so again, treating it like an offlane and just prioritizing Quaifa's farm as much as possible. We do have a pretty much empty lane here at bottom as Korok is trying to find that first creep. Not really the creep you wanted to see, though. The Hellbear Smasher. Yeah.
Okay, so that was interesting. I don't know if you caught that, but Korok ate the hard camp creep and then he warded his magic bush. So that means if Way 2 is going to roam down here, they're not going to have this. He's not going to have that camp to work with. But lucky for Way 2, he doesn't really have any reason to because none of his camps are warded up top.
Yeah, at the same time, this also means that Keeper of Light, he's a pretty decent jungler in his own right as soon as he gets to level 3, so that's not going to have that stack available to him. I feel that may be a little
I don't
premature.
Think he should have warded the bush, because that's going to block the small camp, the pull camp.
Yeah.
Maybe just warded the hard camp, and like if you can put it like right here, where you like see the rune and block the camp, maybe that would have been a better decision, but... We'll see what he tries to do. He might just try and zone the lone druid, but I don't know how that's going to work or not. These lanes are really good for Liquid.
Yeah, right now Liquid's just playing a little passive in this top lane. TC's trying to pull as much as possible and make sure he doesn't get caught out by the Shadow Demon. While the mid lane, Snake King is already being caught out by the rotation of the Enchantress, and this will be your first blood as the Hellbear Smasher puts in that work. So, as we expected, the smoke gank coming in from the Enchantress. Making a very, very easy kill. Like you said, it's just a free kill for this lane.
Yep, that was a really good kill. It's perfect rotation. And NAR has no sight of the Enchantress at all, so she's going to have free reign over the opponents. But Way 2 is coming down into this jungle now. He's going to be disappointed. There's nothing really to use. And he needs his boots if he wants to stay here. He can't just sit out in the enemy jungle and expect to not get punished.
Right. That's a good point. He's going to find another Hellbearer Smasher. Not bad at all. In the other hard camp, at the same time, we saw a little bit of action at this top lane where Demon getting a little bit low, but is going to be able to survive through the combo, and you may see another rotation through mid. He's got the help air smasher in the position. He may try and go for maybe a little bit of dive here, but Snake King sitting at full health, unlikely. Just go ahead and farm up the jungle as much as possible, I suppose.
And a lot of this game is going to be on Bulba to set the tempo and create space for his Lone Druid. And I think he should be able to, especially with that good early, with the good start from the kill. But Lycan, you know, is back on top of CS already. He just, once these wolves get leveled up, the gas doesn't really affect them because of the magic damage reduction.
Right.
And it can be, it's really easy to zone mid heroes with the wolves.
Yeah, especially when he gets,
when he gets level 5 and they can be invis.
Yeah, he's Alchemist also being a hero that has very little armor in the beginning, so pretty susceptible to a lot of
things. That's okay though, because Alchemist can still de-push his tower, so like it's not going to be able to push it, and he's also a good roaming hero, so he can kind of leave the lane, even though like he's not going to win mid in the CS war, so he can just leave and go get some free kills.
Now, what do you think the build is going to be for Bulba? I'm kind of interested to see whether or not Shadowblade's going to make a rise again if we do see more Alchemist pickup. We've seen a couple of Shadowblade pickups on Furions of late after the buff that happened. Do you think that's a possibility that we could be seeing more Shadowblade for the Alchemist?
I think if you have a super good start and you need that extra core for damage, you might be able to do it. Oh, action top.
Yeah, TC's going to go down as it's going to be a trade, though, as Centaur goes down as well. Demon trying to go aggressive up against Fog. Fog not going to be able to land it, but still gets the kill. Double kill going the way of Fog as Demon plays a little too aggressive there and tries to get real greedy. So favorable trade there for North American Rejects. They lose their Centaur, but now Fogged is in a very good position as a support. We're going to have rotation bottom lane, though. Oh, the Nintangle comes in, and 1437 will fall because of that. Probably was going to go down anyway since Chantress was going to get a net, but still unfortunate timing. Back to top lane, TC is going to be able to pick up the kill on Fogged, but he's going to be traded. Brax now picking up level 4 off of that. Another good trade for North American Rejects.
I think that was a pretty good trade for Liquid, though.
Really?
The Charidium was level 5 when he died, so TC's almost level 5 now as well. I mean, it's not the best trade, but a Shadow Shaman getting a kill like that, it's... This hero is much more, it's much harder to get levels on Shadow Shaman than it is on a Shadow Demon.
Yeah, that's a really good point, the faster you can get level 6. Oh, Korok getting low here, but the Blast comes in.
God.
Oh, barely sneaks by Koifa. He's still running away, though. Last hits are still going to come out. They're just too damn fast in the jungle. We had Snake King and Way2 making a little back and forth engagement here, but he's just going to be chased out of the jungle, and Korok teleports back to base. So 4-4, 5.5 minutes in. A lot of action so far, as we may see. Well, it's unlikely they can really go for a kill here without Shapeshift.
There's no ticket for this tournament yet, right?
There is not. I'm not sure if there ever will be, just because the Gigabyte Challenge is fairly inconsistent.
Right.
It just kind of happens, like, whenever there's time for it, pretty much. We are going to have a rotation into middle lane. Snake King's going to pop the Shapeshift to try and get himself some distance away from that unstable concoction, and will deter both the Batrider as well as the Alchemist away.
Yeah, it's good backup by Demon, but not really necessary. Demon's gonna pick up a haste bottoms, pretty good for a bat. Might be able to look to farm the enemy jungle, but unfortunately it's still warded.
Yeah, now Koifa, they're making that swap again where we do have our lone druid at the top lane, and Demon may have to go into jungle here if he feels a little unsafe about this bottom lane.
Centaur's level 6 now, and Koifa is actually not skilling his ultimate on lone druid. I feel like this was definitely a mistake, and he might die for it right here.
Yeah, he's just so damn squishy. He did go for the extra little bit of mobility with the face boots, but you're right. If the centaur is able to just pop that ultimate and run at him, or the Shattered Demon ever catches him out with the disruption, he's going to be hard-pressed to survive here. It's going to have to rely on lucky entangles.
Oh, he can catch him easily with the diving on mid.
Yeah, Centaur ultimate going to be popped, making sure that the hasted Batrider won't be able to catch up, and that means a stun onto Alchemist, who's already taken the tower. Now the Blast comes through. A little bit of regen, but it's not enough. Still going to fall as 1437 picks up. Last hit, top lane. Centaur trying to get away, but trade for trade there. Alchemist going down in exchange for the Centaur at the top lane.
That was big for TC, but that was a very optimistic play by Liquid on mid. Trying to gank the Lycan when he has his ultimate up. and the Batrider doesn't even have blink yet, so Demon's trying to make kills with out of blink. He should just focus on farming it, because he'll just be way more effective, like, with the blink, obviously.
They're going to try for another kill on the Centaur. They know he doesn't have ultimate, so he's going to get caught out here by the net first. Now with this follow-up disables, they didn't get the trap in time. And that should have been a trade there, one for one, if only the War Trap had been able to land on the Centaur. Instead, it's just a kill on Demon that goes down in favor of North American Rejects. At the very least, though, they will be able to pick up this Tier 1 tower.
Yeah, caught it on the bottom. They Fogged walked in with a Purge, and then they just went straight into Doom. Pretty easy kill. Demon's, I mean, he was a safe lane bat, and it was I think his lane went pretty well for the most part. He needs to get this blink. Like, it's, he should have it like within a minute, and he's not going to. So hopefully he gets his stuff together, man.
Trying to chase down Korok a little bit. We also have that top lane being pushed in, the constant pressure being put in by Koifa, who does finally have a level of his ultimate. Bottom tier 1 tower is going to go down soon here as Demon's trying to provide some interference and goes for the deny, but won't be able to get it in time. The rest of the crew should be able to back away. 1437 is going to be teleported to mid lane, leaving Korok alone here, going to get caught just in time by the lasso. Now slowed up as well inside of that acid spray. Another hero lacking in armor. Good disruption's going to go out, but they should still burn him away as Korok. 1-2 right click should be enough. Oh, it's going to be a trade. Demon falls there as Bulba just walks himself away, so not a bad exchange. North American Rejects, that should have just been a free kill on Korok, but fortunately, the rotations come in time from NAR.
That courier, did you see it? It was like flying in. Snaking had it grouped with his wolves, so every time he was microing wolves, he was pulling the courier as well.
Oh, well done, Snaking.
There's a lot of mistakes this game. Like, Liquid, Bulba and Demon mainly are making so many like silly mistakes that are actually costing them a lot of counter kills when this shouldn't happen. Like that, they stacked the stun and the lasso there so much because Bulba didn't think that the lasso was going to go off, but it did. And then he threw a stun anyways, and it was like a low damage, low duration stun. It's just not good stuff.
Well, at least they do have a small recovery mechanism here. The 3 stack on the Ancients with the acid spray. And now double damage, actually. Bulba may be able to clear this just by himself early on. So
yeah, Quickfa has his Midas too on the Lone Druid. He's farming pretty well. But Snaking also on Midas as well, so we'll see. Doom's going on mech. Okay, sorry.
Well, it looks like we're just going to have a 5-man mid-push as North American Rejects doing a great job pushing down these towers. Now the Centaur ultimate going out. The Purge will be able to catch out the Enchantress. That's going to be at least one free kill here. But Bulba coming in with the stun. Going to throw it on the Centaur, though. He's a little too tanky for them to finish off quickly. Fog may get traded here. No, he's going to be able to walk away from those wards in time. And that means the wards are just free gold. But North American Rejects, realizing that there's going to be more rotations, back themselves away, claiming a Tier 1 tower and getting out in the process. The only downside is that Koifa just continues to free farm this top lane. Top tower is under
attack. Yeah, and that was a fight Liquid didn't really need to take. I think they were in no position to fight, and I think way too forgot about the Centaur ultimate for a second. Because this Centaur Shadow Demon, you know, you always think about the disruption into the Centaur who stomp, but another good part of it is that Shadow Demon always has the ability to catch his opponents with no items because of the Centaur ult. And right there you saw it. They just Centaur ulted and then Shadow Demon ran in, purged the Enchantress, and she was going nowhere. And then everyone else just caught up to her.
Right now we do have Bulba farming up his Ancient stack. He's going to clear through that with his double damage rune. So he's going to be getting a lot of gold out of that. But where is this Vit booster? Like, is he actually going for an early?
It's casual. No, it's casual Vit booster. Okay. He just wants some base HP to survive the Shadow Demon Centaur burst.
Right. That makes sense.
And he's probably going to go into a Blink Dagger next item, I believe. Blink is very good on Alchemist. So NAR is grouping up for Tier 1 top, and Liquid might look to do Roshan here, but top tower is under attack. Yes, they're going to look to Rosh. They need a sentry, though. When you play against... Oh, action mid.
Yep, they're going to jump in on TC, getting caught out. Demon going to be able to intercept that one. Good disruption by Fog. will be able to interfere, but they have just too much damage coming out. It's the unstable concoction. Will be able to finish it, but barely. Korok throws a level death over the cliff there in order to kill that Shadow Shaman. Korok being held up, but he's Koifa is actually going to be chased away by this wolf, who's trying to go in the rest of them, but this Haste Rune on Bulba now turns around for the Unstable Concoction. If he can get multiple, good play by Snake King, separating himself from the rest of the herd, making sure they don't get a double stun. And that meets North American Rejects, trading a one for one, not the greatest exchange in the world, but they will continue control of this Roche Pit. Do you think North American Rejects there, when it comes down to maybe taking a tier two or forcing a fight around Roshan? Like, do you let Liquid take Roshan in exchange for getting more map control? Or do you think they're strong enough here to just constantly fight Liquid at every turn?
I think NAR is going to hit their stride right about now, and I think that Liquid is going to be stronger later. And if Liquid can survive through this mech push with the Doom, I think they're going to be okay. But we will see.
Yeah, they sort of got everything they need for this early game. They've got the Lycan, who's got a Vlad's, nothing too major, but just something small. The mech is going to be a huge factor in some of these early team fights, as well as the initiation by the Centaur. And they've hit all of their key levels as well, so I think you're right. Nothing should be stopping NAR from jumping in. They're going to get the stun on the Alchemist, leading on that one. The Vitality Booster, casual bit booster, not doing enough to save him from that five-man gank from North American Rejects. What should be a five-man push here, but Team Liquid still angling to intercept this, despite the fact they're already at Alchemist down. He's going to go in for Brax. Good disruption goes out, but he's still going to be in bad position. Nukes go out, but he's still able to get himself away. Now the turnaround. Doom is already up on TC. He's going to burn out as Caught a Blast finishes him out. Snake King getting low here as the jump in from the Centaur gets a two-man stun. Snake King not going to be able to get away, though, as that turn rate is too low. We have the Enchantress going down as Korok chases him away. Fogged is being chased in. He knows he's going to have to turn around just to try and help out. Korok chasing down Koifa. Well, we do have Fogged. Actually managed to get himself away as the Centaur provides some interference here. Going in on the Alchemist, blinks away just in time, and he's going to find himself an Invis rune, meaning he will be safe. Koifa and Bulba. Such a long drawn out fight. We still have yet to get any real big kills. Korok is going to get caught here as the rotation comes in from the Shadow Shaman, barely being saved though by Brax. Demon comes in, still not enough to finish him off. Centaur will go down, but Korok's Doom finally gets himself away. And I have no idea actually whether North American Rejects or Liquid came out on top from that team fight. That was just such a long drawn out team fight that we had Liquid coming back with those additional heroes as well. They got a couple kills towards the end, but it looks like North American Rejects still managed to come out on top.
It was a pretty close fight. Alchemist had actually bought back and died again, so he's way off of his next item. But Quakefoot did not die at all during that fight, and he picked up quite a bit of gold, I believe, and experience, so he's getting to be pretty strong. I think he misclicked his ultimate, though. Didn't get a level 2 ultimate at 11, which happens more often than you'd think.
Looks like he's got 2,300 gold saved up right now, so may see a Radiance being picked up after that team fight. So overall, went the way of North American Rejects, but that concentrated gold on the Lone Druid is going to be a significant factor, and they're actually going to try and sneak in Roshan right now with the Ward Trap as well as the Lone Druid's physical damage. This is going to be a little
sentry.
Tight, though.
You need a sentry. You're playing against a Lycan. You have to assume that they're always going to be a wolf in there.
That's a good point. Do have Keeper of Light. 1-4-3-7 is throwing in a blast and will be able to reveal that one, but I'm not sure they're going to be able to have the rotation in time as they are pushing in the top lane. And not really doing a whole lot to that tier 2 damage, tier 2 tower just yet. So sure enough, Roshan will fall.
Oh, Fog got the bear kill.
Well, Shadow Poison too strong. Tier 2 is still alive if Liquid want to try and defend that one. Sure enough, double teleports coming in. Bulba, who will not be going for a Blink Dagger. Definitely could have used it right there, but ends up stunning himself. Instead he goes for, what, Armlet here?
I don't know. I think he's tilting.
Well, it's Armlet or Veil, but Veil's not going to help you specifically out with your unstable concoction. You don't have an amazing amount of magic damage, so.
Yeah, I think the dieback is like really affecting him. I feel like he should still go for the blink, but he's not going for it, so we'll see. Let's see what else is going on here. TC is getting a good amount of farm. He hasn't been that effective this game. He's died a lot, 5 deaths. But I think he's just getting blown up by Centaur almost every fight. And he actually got doomed in that bottom fight. But he needs to just try and get his spells off as soon as he can and make sure. Like, whoever Bat is pulling someone into, just get the wards off. And Demon has his 4 staff now, so it should be much easier for TC to be effective.
Yeah, the lack of farm. You called it early on when you were talking about how Demon needed to have a blink dagger about that 9.5 minute mark. And that lack of gold has kind of been snowballing against them. It's like a 4 staff in that situation, that initial fight where they jumped in on the Centaur, would have made a huge difference. But because the Centaur was able to get away, he just was constantly blinking back in and providing interference when necessary with that hoof stomp. And actually played a significant factor.
Yeah, they're okay, though. I think they're surviving the storm pretty well. They're going to try and grab this 2 on bottom. And Liquid, or NAR is going to just try and trade for top. Oh, shit. Way too. No.
Yeah, going to get doomed up. He
got his Wisp Spirit off. He should be okay.
Oh, man. Yeah, the heal's too much with the Untouchable going out. One of the few passives that doesn't actually get disabled by Doom. So they do get away. Demon's going to be able to snag Fog, put him up on the cliff. The attempt at a teleport, not going to be in time as TC cancels that one with the Hex. But they're still drawing a lot of attention. Snake King's going to start pushing uphill. Sees the one teleport, though, and backs out.
He is going Necrobook.
Yeah.
I don't know if I like that, Snake King. Do you think
Doom should also pick up a Necrobook too, then? If we're
maybe that's what he just bought an item. What did he get? He got a blink. Okay. I mean, that's good on Doom.
Yeah.
He kind of lacks mana though on the Doom. I guess if he's gonna get Chakra, it's gonna be okay. But generally, when you go this blink, I mean, it's not that bad anymore now that blink doesn't cost mana. But the blink mech Doom is usually very mana intensive.
Whoa,
so.
Teeming. How many times do you see a Batrider trying to initiate with a 4 staff? He's going to get caught out here. Double stomps going down. 2 different Centaur stomps will be able to finish him off. I have no idea what Demon was doing there. Like, he blinked in and 4 staffed himself closer to the Keeper of the Light. And he didn't have Lasso either. And he didn't have any backup. I have no clue what his thought process was there. But whatever it was, he paid for it.
Uh-huh. Classic Jimmy. LOL. XD. XP.
Good old Jimmy. Well, at least they killed the Lone Druid Bear, so they got themselves a little bit of extra gold there on that pickoff. Man, 1437, he's farmed as all hell. He's got an Aghanim Scepter and now just picks up a gem for his team, because why the hell not? He's already got Ags before the 20-minute mark, so might as well just start taking some map control away.
He's got the third highest CS in the game, so Dire's
middle tower is he really does.
He's definitely farming.
Really does. Net worth wise, he's actually sitting right in the middle above Batrider as well as the Alchemist. Ridiculous. Ridiculous.
Armlet finished on Alchemist here.
Well, at least this Alchemist is going to be tanky as hell, right?
I mean, he still has no armor, but we'll see.
We do have Necrobook 3 is going to be finished up real soon here by Snake King, and that means the split push is.
The Radiance is finished as well. I don't know if we caught that.
Yeah.
But they have the Aegis on Lone Druid. But can they push into Caudle?
Well, it is nighttime, so at least they don't have to deal with the healing. So that's one small factor. But right, it is going to be tough for them to be able to go up that hill. TC halfway to his Aghanim's upgrade for the Shadow Shaman. We're going to see a late mech picked up by Way 2 on the Enchantress. And they do back themselves away. Keeper of the Light, too strong.
Necro 3, there it is. Way 2, target that. The Mauler. What is it called? What's the melee one called? The Warrior?
Yeah, Warrior. Warrior.
Yeah. Or at least you can get that.
In Dota 1.
Say what?
In Dota 1, it was the Warrior and the Archer. I don't know.
Yeah, that's what it is. It says on the tooltip.
So both teams kind of stalling out right now. We have a bit of just kind of like AFK farming. You said Team Liquid are going to get stronger later. North American Rejects, what items do they need to have then to continue taking objectives? Because we still have 2 tier 2s up. Do we wait for maybe the second Necronomicon 3 if Korok chooses to go that build? Like, what other items are we really waiting for North American Rejects?
I think at this point, I think they're just content going to late game up against the bear. And they're just going to farm up like a Shiva on Doom. And I'm not sure what other items, because Lycan's going to peek, and then I don't know how strong Centaur and these two supports can be. Like, Kalos is Ags now, but what do you go now? Like, Hex? Like, the hero doesn't... Yeah. All of its damage is based on Illuminate and Mana Leak.
That's a good point.
Caught the bear, though.
Yep, he does have another one, so just Koifa going to have to be careful for the next 2 minutes. Do have the attempt at any sort of split push is not going to work out. As you can see, Demon trying to set up for a kill here, but it's actually going to be the other way around. As the Centaur ultimate goes out, they're going to be able to catch out TC. Now the disruption goes down as well on Bulba, who doesn't have his ultimate for another 12 seconds, and he's taking down in mana thanks to that mana leak. Still continuing forward, Korok going with a little bit of body blocking, but the phase boots come out. Now the Blink Dagger going to be able to hit the stun, and Bulba will fall as all five heroes. And that constant recall is doing some work right now for the Keeper of the Light. Constantly being able to move around the map, and if he wants to, he can go bottom and dress the split pushing from Koifa.
1437 plays this call so well. Like, he's just always in the right place, and he's always, whether it's recalling people, but he's... The main thing, I think he's just always ready with the Illuminates. Whenever Liquid's trying to get some pressure going, he's just there to destroy it by himself.
The attempt at a kill on Way 2's Enchantress there, but Brax was barely off the mark with the hoof stomp, so he canceled it. Koifa is pushing in this bottom lane, and no one is here yet to really be able to address that, but we do have a possible trade going on, as the tier 2 mid is going to go down, and Snake King is forcing the attention to top lane as well. So it looks like they're probably going to go uphill with these four, try and force a fight in middle while Snake King sneaks in a tier 3, or the other way around. Either way, Demon focusing on Snake King first. Now he's actually going to try and go in, but didn't get the lasso there, got a little scared. And tier 3 towers are going to start taking some serious damage. Glyph is going to be forced out, and Koifa is going to be forced back as well.
Come on, Demon. Let's see some plays, man. Batrider is such like a playmaking hero, and if you make mistakes on him, the game gets really difficult. Like, Liquid's obviously crutching on the Batrider lasso to set up kills, and they're just not having good fights and good initiation right now, so it's very difficult for them to win any fights. They have a mech now and Enchantress, but I'm worried it's not going to be enough.
Yeah, that would have been a big pickoff there. I mean, that is one of those perfect Batrider scenarios where it just should have been able to bring a hero into the base, but...
He's got to go on the Shadow Demon. Fogged's very, very quick on the disruptions every time so far, and we're going to have a fight here.
Yeah, he's going to go in for Brax, bring him down the cliff and into the rest of his allies. Really great play there. A very fortunate haste rune. Fog going to hit the disruption here. They're going to try and focus on Demon, but he's just way too fast. The purge goes out, but it's not before he gets down the cliff. And now they're trying to make their way up the staircase here. North American Rejects are going to back themselves away. Already losing the Centaur is a significant factor, but Bulba is on the pursuit, going to be able to hit the stun on Fog. And he does have a disruption to throw down on himself, but it's not really going to save him in the end. Good four staff actually going down as we have yet to get an entangle. This bear is still working on now the disruption goes out. They're actually going to be able to provide a little bit of turn here. Mech goes down from Korok and they are able to save their support. And Way 2 actually overextends himself. Pops the heal, but now it's going to be the other way around where team's just getting chased out and should be one hero, possibly even two. They get the other support. Shadow Shaman gets picked off by Korok and the Doom being used to stop the Enchantress from teleporting away. So both supports will go down. In the end, all in exchange for a Centaur. Not bad, especially since they're recalling the Centaur in already, and looks like they're going to be going for a 5-man push through top lane while those supports are still on deck.
Yeah, that was crazy, the Shadow Demon. I think he lived. Did he even die?
No, he didn't. He got himself away.
He healed up with the Claw Illuminate, and then Korok blinked in, and...
Everything. Centaur ultimate being used just to be able to chase down this bear. They do get the kill.
If you kill someone with Centaur ult, does Centaur get the kill or does the hero?
I believe the hero, whoever runs over them, gets the kill.
Alright. Just checking.
Yeah, because it works, that's the same way with creeps, you know, so.
Sure. Okay, Roshan, so...
Being focused.
Roshan.
This is
Fireflies on cooldown. It's not good.
In. They have no idea. I mean, they could have been scouting out with the Lone Druid right now, but free Roche going the way, and this also means a BKB for Snake King, so a significant upgrade for a lot of his teamfight damage. He won't be disrupted and taken out of the teamfight as easily during that shapeshift time. Not disrupted, but hexed up.
Yeah, he should probably just save it for a root, I think.
Yeah.
It's pretty good against Enchantress, too, because not only can you avoid impetus damage, but you can also attack through Untouchable, which is rather annoying if you're playing a carry and you're trying to kill the Enchantress.
Five-man rotation uphill. We do have the Assault Cuirass that was finished up by the Lone Druid, but Liquid still trying to weather the storm of the pushing power of North American Rejects. Tower already being